university. So what we plan, because she told us to give an overview what we'll be speaking. So first, maybe first few lectures we'll discuss more on algorithm. These are algorithm because I'm from computer science, and computer science people, they built algorithms, correct? And so this is a different sort of algorithm. I mean, I will come to that a little bit, I will talk. But the thing is that our goal is to talk about more optimization, correct? These are all optimization tools. So I will start with single objective optimization, and Anirban will go into more into multi-objective optimization, which is more state of the art, okay? And then actually both of us are from computer science, and nowadays you know that machine learning, data science are becoming so important. So we'll take a little bit of example from data science and machine learning, and we'll show you how this sort of algorithm you can use them, because data science and machine learning is extremely important, challenging field now. Maybe I will take one example from computational biology also. So, but our goal is to show you how these algorithms works, okay? Fine? So please stop me in between if you have any questions, okay? And ask me. And during 2 days we will be here, so maybe during lunch and dinner we can speak, and okay, breakfast we can speak, okay? So let's start. And so this is a very interesting term. It's called soft computing. Now, if you have little bit knowledge in computer science, so what we do, we design algorithms, correct? And for the algorithms, you need to know the basic architecture of the machine, the data structure. And actually, the problems we divided, like in terms of computer science, we divided into easy problem, difficult problem, more difficult problem, okay? And in computer science, we call, like, assume there are n points, so, okay, n point, maybe n integer number, and somebody asks you to find the highest number or the lowest number, okay? So basically, it's an easy problem. You have n points, you can put it into an array. In computer science, it's called data structure, and then you can find the position of the element, correct? Fine, highest or lowest, or maybe if you are doing average, so it's an easy problem. So in computer science, we called it, simple, easy problem, because the complexity, because I'm not going into the algorithm course more detail, but you should understand the complexity is very low. It's called order of n. What is order of n? If you have n number of element, n is the number of points, then in polynomial time, I will be able to find the minimum or a maximum or maybe average. Okay, so easy problem. Similarly, sorting. Assume some point are given. Again, you can assume it's an integer or a real number, and somebody asks me to sort it. So the best algorithm known in the computers are n log n. So again, a polynomial. So whenever you are giving me an algorithm whose complexity is polynomial, then I'm very happy, because computer very easily can solve this. But in the most real life problems, you will find that many problems are not, you cannot solve in polynomial amount of time. So then what to do? Because they are non-polynomial. That means their complexity will go to, if I have n, n is the sample size. For searching, sorting, n is number of element. In graphs, if you talk about graphs algorithm, n can be number of nodes. And the complexity of the, if the complexity of the algorithm is a to the power n, where a is more than 1, then it is a bit difficult problem. Okay? So because as soon as a will start increasing, if you draw a graph, n is in x-axis and your a to the power n is the y-axis, you will see that as the value of n started increasing, the graph will rapidly increase. The total time taken by the computer will be huge. So that's a difficult problem. Okay, I will come one to that quickly. And there is a, because I'm introducing this, soft computing is very popular in computer science or maybe related area. Why? Because sometimes in some real-life problem, you actually do not want to know the exact solution. Maybe you will be very happy if you find a near optimal solution. For example, assume there are two lines, okay? Two marked line, and somebody asks you to park a car, okay? So, you know, parking car is a bit difficult because that is the best test, okay? When you are going back and parking real place, especially in the big cities. Kolkata, Bangalore is also like a lot of traffic jams, okay? Parking is a car, not easy job. But if somebody asks you to park the car exactly in between, that means you will be some meter away from the right marks, from the left, top, bottom. It is extremely difficult problem. Parking the car exactly in between is an extremely difficult problem. But if you think very carefully, in the real life, do you do that? No. We simply park the car in between, not exactly. So that is much easier problem. So that is the reason it is called soft computing. Hard computing means always you are looking for the optimal solution. Correct? But in the soft computing, which you don't always look for the optimal solution. Because if I can park the car in between, I'm happy. Because police won't arrest me, I won't have to pay fine. There is no need to go for exactly. So these are called soft computing because you are not taking the problem as a hard problem. You are changing the problem into soft problem. Correct? So this is called soft computing. And in the soft computing, you know already there are a lot of NLP terms may coming. If you tell a computer a person is high or tall. Okay, tall in Germany and tall in India are not same. Correct. Germany 5'10" means short. And India 5'10" means relatively tall. So what domain you are talking, that is very important. Similarly, if you talk about the temperature of a person when he or she has a fever, and temperature in the nuclear reactor is quite different. Correct? So it's coming. So basically these terms is associated with a domain. Correct? So if you can identify the domain, then it is easy. Otherwise, it's very difficult. And in the computer, when we write a term, linguistic term, the person is tall, the computer don't understand the meaning of tall or short. So it is important to tell the computer what you mean by that. So this is called linguistic. So, or emphasis on terms, okay. So basically NLP and you can use fuzzy theory, fuzzy set. It's simple mathematics. So I'm not going to the detail. And then our goal is mostly to find a low-cost solution, because high-cost solution may take a lot of time. I will give you an example later on, a little bit later on. And basically, these sort of algorithms always try to mimic the natural system. For example, nowadays you know that deep learning is coming very, very strong way, because in the machine learning is one of the best tool. And neural network, it was developed long back. And basically, neural network try to mimic the human brain. We want to learn something. If you want to learn something, then basically you use neural network type of system. If you want to handle imprecision or impurity, then you use fuzzy set, rough set, all these things. Similarly, if you are looking for any search techniques, you can use this kind of genetic algorithms. There are so many algorithms. They are called either evolutionary or maybe meta-heuristic, so everything. But again, this is the introduction course, so I will talk about very simple one, and Anirban will go to the more complex one, okay? In 2 days we'll do. And Professor Jade coined the term, the soft computing, and it's very popular now, okay? So, and these are different components of soft computing, so rough set, fuzzy set, little bit of mathematics, neural network for learning, deep learning is very, very important, all my students work with deep learning. So basically they try to learn, basically when you want to learn the environment, you use this kind of technique. Then you can use all these search, we'll talk one about that. Then maybe you can do probabilistic reasoning, chaos theory, everything you can do, all are part of soft computing, correct? So let us talk to genetic algorithms, because genetic algorithm is a search technique which mimics again some natural genetic system. But be sure about one thing, there is no biology, correct? I also do a lot of work with biology, but there is no biology. At the end of the day, people expect that you will write a simple code, and that code will help you to search something, search. Okay? So be sure about that. I'm not going into detail. You already understand that here, basically it will mimic some natural genetic system, and it's called randomized search, because in the process you will find lot of random things, but even then it works. There is a match. I don't want to become, if you have little bit idea of hidden Markov model, you can do the modeling part, but it's in the slide, but I don't want to discuss because it can take a lot of time. But it slides, all the things are there. So let me proceed. So let us take quickly one example, why this type of algorithms are so popular. So assume this is a problem, very important problem in graph theory, all of you might know. This is called traveling salesman problem. What is that? So assume there are N cities. Let us talk about India. So you have Bangalore, Delhi, Kolkata, okay, Ahmedabad, Chennai, so many cities. Assume you are sitting in Bangalore, you want to send your representative through all the cities, once and exactly once, and you want your employee will come back to Bangalore. So maybe from Bangalore he can go to Chennai or Bombay first, then Delhi, then he need to cover all the cities once and exactly once. That is important. You cannot visit any city more than once. Okay? And then you come back to Bangalore. So this is a typical graph algorithm. We do a lot of work in graph algorithm because graph is a part of computer science. Okay? And this is called Hamiltonian cycle. So if you already know what is Hamiltonian cycle. Hamiltonian cycle means in a graph, it's a connected graph. Let us talk about a connected graph. You are visiting through all the cities, one and all the nodes once and exactly once, and you need to return to the original one. So that is a Hamiltonian cycle. If you cut one of the edges, it's Hamiltonian path. Then you can do a lot of mathematics, given a completely connected graph. You possibly know what is completely connected graph. A completely connected graph means from every vertex, you find an edge to other vertex. Okay. In the real life, what is an edge means? I have two cities, like Bangalore to Delhi. So edge means you are connecting Bangalore to Delhi. And right now we are talking about a graph which is weighted graph. Why? Because from Bangalore to Delhi, you need to spend some money to go, correct? And you can assume that is the weight of the edge, correct? If you fly, then it's more, weight is more. If you go by train, it's less, okay? Fine. So given a, now the problem is, given a graph, can you find it? So basically, we are talking about a weighted graph, and in the weighted graph, we are trying to find a Hamiltonian cycle, and basically, your goal is to find such a Hamiltonian cycle. There can be a number of Hamiltonian cycles. If you can do a permutation, correct, you can understand. Every permutation is a kind of Hamiltonian cycle. If it's a complete graph means if there are n vertices, from every vertices, you can go to the other vertices directly, not indirectly. So if I have n vertices, basically I have n situations, correct? Then you, any permutation you take, that could be an Hamiltonian cycle if the edge is not repeated. So you can do a mathematics, those who are good in mathematics, you can find upper limit and lower limit of Hamiltonian cycle, correct? But now our goal is to find such a Hamiltonian cycle where the total sum of the cost of the edges is minimum. Because I'm looking for that. I want to send my representative through all the cities in such a way that total sum of the edge cost is minimum. That means I will pay minimum money. Okay? So I want to look for that. So this is called objective. What is your objective? Your objective is to spend minimum money. That means I want to reduce the cost as far as possible. So that is an optimization problem. And right now I'm talking about one objective. Total sum of the edge cost. But in the nature, you already know the problems are not single objective, it's multi-objective. If one objective is total cost, what is the other? At least there is one more. What is that? Definitely time. And you see they are conflicting in nature. So if I want to reduce the time, I need to fly. Maybe with a better flight, cost will high. And as soon as you are trying to bring down the cost, your time will go up. So are multi-objective. So anyone will talk more on multi-objective. And today, after 20 years working in this domain, I can always vouch that you go for multi-objective. Single objective is very easy. But multi-objective, you need to be very careful. Okay? What is your objective? How do you define your objective for any problem? Because all these algorithms are developed by civil engineers, mechanical engineers. So you can use it in any domain. Okay? Use it a lot up for data mining and data science, we use it for biology. You can use it for any domain, okay? But don't use it blindly, so that's my point. So let us talk about this problem. So basically, you are talking about a graph, and then you need to find a Hamiltonian cycle, okay? So for simplicity, we took 8 cities, and we put into a grid. Why? Because it is very easy for you to understand. And let us assume that if you go from A to B, basically you are paying 1 plus 1. 2 edge, so basically cost is 2. If you diagonally move, this is 1 plus 1 root of 2, root 2. So that's the way you should compute. So can you tell me, given a problem, we always tell our student, don't use this kind of algorithm initially, because it's very easy to use a genetic algorithm, but there are so many algorithms. So basically you can have ant colony optimization, swarm optimization, swarm algorithm, every day new algorithms are coming. So don't use them blindly. So first thing, can you design your whole algorithm from the domain knowledge? So in computer science, those who are a little bit of computer science knowledge, is very easy. So what we can do, so we can immediately, given all the nodes, we can immediately design or find a spanning tree. So what is a spanning tree? A spanning tree of a graph. You give me a graph, I can give you a spanning tree. There's an algorithm. So what I can do, I can take one of the vertices as the root, and then I need to form a tree in such a way, it's a tree, so that means all are connected, and there should be no cycle. And what is a spanning tree? A spanning tree should contain all the vertices of the edge, of the graph, all the vertices of the graph. So that is called spanning tree. Correct? So, and there is no cycle. Cycle means it cannot be tree. Correct? So the, I will show you. If there is any cycle, so a tree cannot have a cycle. So what is a tree? It's a acyclic graph. It's a graph, simple graph theory. Correct? So what is a spanning tree? A tree which contain, tree means it's there cannot be any cycle, and a tree which contain all the vertices of the graph. So that's called a spanning tree. And in computer science, there are two very easy algorithms are there. I'm not going into the detail. One is called Prim's algorithm, another one is called Kruskal. You can check Prim's or Kruskal. And they, in polynomial time, is able to find the minimum spanning tree. Again, what do you mean by minimum here? Minimum means after generating the spanning tree, I will sum all the edges, weight of the edges, and it should be minimum. Okay, if you give me two trees, two spanning tree, one's edge, total sum of the edge cost is minimum, then the other, I will prefer that over the other. Okay, again, so one objective, correct? One objective. So this is the spanning tree. So as so basically, this is your initial graph. So I'm starting from Ahmedabad, correct? So I took Ahmedabad as the root of the tree and I generate a spanning tree. Very easy algorithm, you can find the code and everything. Okay? So this is called minimum spanning tree. Very, very important in graph theory. Okay. And as soon as you have a minimum spanning tree, what you can do, there is a concept of p-order traversal. In the tree, you can do a traversal. What is that p-order traversal? It's again very easy. In our computer science, second year student go for this kind of thing for data structure and other things. So what you do, you start from any node, correct? Maybe A is your root. Root means the first node. And then you traverse the rest, and basically we are talking about a binary tree. Every node has two children. So you first traverse the left part, okay, and then the right part, okay. So that is the idea, and you do it recursively. So that's the concept. So what you do, you traverse first A, then the left is B and right is D. So you go to the B part. So A, again from the B you repeat it. So you go to C. Then you cannot go anything, so you'll have to go back to B. So this is called backtracking in computer science. And the data structure is called linked list, so you can backtrack from one node to the other. And then I am going to the right-hand side, H, correct? So again, I cannot go anywhere. So I will have to backtrack to B, again backtrack to A. Now I will expand the right-hand side, okay? So we'll go to D, D to E, again right, only one child. Then to the left part, again backtrack, right part, I'm finished, I will go back to A. So this is your traversal, okay? But during Hamiltonian cycle, what we mentioned, that no node can be traversed more than once, correct? So that is the Hamiltonian concept of the Hamiltonian cycle. So what you can do, whatever repetition is there, you drop it. So first I will start from A, then I will go to B, then C, but then I cannot come to B, correct? B is, as if I go to B, it cannot be Hamiltonian. So I will have to go to, I drop B, I will go to H directly. From H, I cannot go this way. I will have to go to D. Then maybe E, F, G, and come back to A. Fine? So what is my algorithm? So basically, it looks like that. So this is your Hamiltonian cycle. Correct? So what is the algorithm? So let's come back again. So given the nodes, or the correct, or maybe the city, what do you think? So what I will do, I will first call, we call function call. We call a function that will give me a spanning tree, okay, minimum spanning tree. So for that, I already mentioned there is an algorithm, two very standard algorithm called Prim's or Kruskal. You can use any one of them. I am not discussing. It will take a lot of time. And then you can do a pre-ordered traversal. And if you do pre-ordered traversal, you will get this. Then you drop the repeated edge and you finally will come to this. So this is your Hamiltonian cycle, and now if you sum the cost of the edges. So this is 2, this is root 2, then you can continue like this. Basically, your cost is 19.074. You may not have. Then it's not Hamiltonian. Then it's a different concept. You'll have to come back to Govati and then again. So basically that's a different sort of algorithm. That's not Hamiltonian. Yeah, always, always. I mean, not everybody is in the text. You'll have to find your own algorithm. It's not very difficult. Then you'll have to figure it out. Also, there could be time constraint and all these things. So problems are not so simple in the real life. This is an example to understand. Okay. So you see, your total cost is 19.074. But this is a 8-city problem, so even you can compute by hand, or maybe you can write a small code and computer, maybe in few seconds will tell you what is the best optimal one. The optimal one is this one, 14.714. So what I will tell? Immediately I will conclude this is a very poor solution. Because my optimal is, see, 14.715, and you are giving me this is. So this is a very, very poor solution. I cannot accept that. What you can accept? If your actual solution is 14.715, if I am giving you 14.72, okay, you will be more or less happy. But you cannot accept. You can see in 14, you have almost 4.5%, I mean, say 20% increase of cost. That is not acceptable. And believe me, if you use this kind of algorithm, genetic algorithm or differential evolution, you can expect your algorithm will go close to that one. May not be 14.715, but you can expect that your algorithm will be go very close. That is the reason people use it. But again, if you use it blindly, it has a lot of problems. I will come to that later on. So you need some domain knowledge. So how we design this algorithm? From our domain knowledge, graph theoretic knowledge. And that is called your domain expertise. Okay, or you are designing in computer science, we called it designing a heuristic. So basically we developed an heuristic algorithm. What is our heuristic? Given a graph, you draw the spanning tree, then do a p-order traversal and drop the edges, repeated edges. So that is my heuristic. Okay, as soon as I'm doing that, I'm very confident on the graph. So now I can manipulate my genetic algorithms also. That is the reason. Yes, come on. Optimal one. So for the 8-city, it is very easy. You can do all, you can enumerate all of them and whichever is best, that one. Okay, that is called enumerative technique. So I will find all the search space and whichever is best, I will take this. It takes huge amount of time, but you know it's an 8-city. So you can do it for 8-city, not for 50 cities. For the 50 cities, even for a superpower computer, it may take 2 days. Because it's exponential, its complexity is almost 2 to the power n. Very fast it will. So for 100 cities, it is enormously large. So you cannot generate all the solution. What would be the best? If I can find all the solution, then I can compare. So that is called enumerative. In the search space, I will go to every feasible point where my solution is there. I will test all of them, and then I will take the best. Okay, but you cannot do it for a complex problem. For a simple problem, you can do it. Okay, this is, I can do because it is very simple, 8. Your sample point is 8. But as soon as you started increasing beyond 50, not possible. Okay, it takes so much time. And on the other hand, why the problem is so difficult? Assume I want to send my representative, what is the time now? This is 10, I want to send my representative maybe around 11, so I have one hour time. So I cannot go for any solution which takes for a computer to find out in more than 1 hour time. So that's the real situation. So you are a manager, you need to take the decision right now. So you cannot go for any luxury kind of solution. You'll have to go very fast. Okay. So that is the reason in the real life, there is a lot of challenges you need to face. Okay? Yes. No cycle. There is no cycle. It depends, because I told, because I do a lot of work on social network, that is computer science stuff, and so I started with a very easy one. So if I go to a complex, it is difficult for you to understand. Social network, I will discuss because I worked with social network. So there you can build up community. Biology also you do. You can do many things in social network, okay? Yes, you need to modify it then. So Matman will talk more on that because then I may have more objectives. Here I have only simple one objective. I am looking toward the cost. Maybe two objectives. So you can increase the number of objectives. And as soon as you are doing that, the algorithm will also be different. And it is not a very easy algorithm. It's more sophisticated. So you can always define it. Okay. So that is the reason I told these genetic algorithms and these are very important. Okay. So people very quickly can get result. I mean, even if you do not know much things. So let us talk about different traditional search techniques. So basically, we already know that gradient descent or calculus-based method works very well when you have function is continuous, so you can do a derivative, and there is one optima, single optima. So you can do a derivative. So never use this kind of algorithm for such scenario because it's a derivative search. Just you do a dy dx and immediately you will get the solution. So don't do that. But unfortunately, most of the real-life problems, search case may not be continuous. Even that is first problem. Second, it may not be derivable at all. So it's very difficult. In real life, we don't have very good scenario. Okay. So basically, but if the problem is so simple, you cannot, you don't use it. For multimodal, what happened? You assume this is a multimodal problem and you are looking for the global minima. Correct. This is a global and these are, you have so many locals. Okay. Now, why when calculus-based method works well? Assume I started from here. Surely I will go to this one. Correct. So if you do it, this is your y, this is x. This is basically f of x. Correct. Y-axis. So if I do a derivative in this point, it is decreasing this way. Correct. Fine. Finally, it will come to that. In both the direction, derivative increase. So your final result will be this. You understand? So if your search start from here, your final result will be this. You will be never able to go to that one. Fine, this is called trapping to local optima. And in real life, it happens always. If you use very simple techniques, then many times you may be trapped to local optima, although you want to go to the global. So then what you can do, the best you can do, randomly you take your some initial position, and then if you are lucky, sometimes if you are somewhere here in this part of the curve, then you will go to the global. But that is not a very good idea. But people also do that. You start from different random positions. And if you are lucky, sometimes you will be in this curve. And finally, your that gradient descent search will take you to the global optima. Okay, that's the idea. Okay. But again, you remember then function need to be at least derivable. If it is not derivable, then you cannot do this, okay. In computer science, there are some better techniques called dynamic programming. I already told the best could be enumerative. That means every position I will find the solution, then I will compare whichever is best, I will take that. But that takes huge amount of time for complex problem. A better is dynamic programming. In computer science, it's a operation research things also. So you can do, even dynamic programming is also costly. So, that's not a good, always you cannot do. For some problem, maybe you can use dynamic programming. There is another interesting programming in computer science, it's called branch and bound. So basically you are generating a tree, and from some part of the tree, if you can find this left search or right search will not give me a good solution, then you can prune the part of the tree. And in this way, you can improve your timing. Correct. Why we are doing it? Because we want to find a solution quickly. If I have enough time, I can always do enumerative search, but I do not have that amount of time. So maybe dynamic programming is an improvement. Branch and bound is better than that, but even that also takes a lot of time. So that is the reason people depend on this kind of search. Okay. So, and if you do a random search, totally random, then that basically you have no idea. You can jumping from here to here. So in the long run, it won't perform well. So that's the reason we told, if you have a specialized algorithm, it will do very well for some problem, but generally won't do it. But this kind of genetic algorithm over any problem, over any domain, like civil, mechanical, power, biology, economics. So I think on it one will talk a little bit of some problems from economics also. Okay. And then these techniques are much better, always. But don't use them blindly, it may happen. So basically, as soon as I'm talking about genetic algorithm, you have a concept. Basically, I already mentioned it's a search and optimization technique. You are writing an algorithm, we will try to optimize something. For the TSP, traveling salesman problem, we are trying to optimize the total cost of travel. It can be time also, then it's multi-objective. But this lecture, I will talk only on the single objective. Maybe later on, we'll introduce multi-objective. Yeah, correct? And it is used principle of evolution. Again, so basically, it is mimicking some natural genetic system. But remember, there is no biology. At the end of the day, you'll have to write a code. And the code will run and give you some result. Correct? But you will take some principles from the biology and work with the parameter of the coding of the parameter and so on. So you will come across this kind of concept. There is a concept of chromosome, like every human being or any species, we have a concept of chromosome. You have DNA, ATGC, and all these things. We do some biology, so I understand now. And then you have a concept of gene. You have a set of genes. It's called a population. And then you will use the Darwin theory of principle of survival of the fittest. That means who will more fit, that will get more time, and we'll do it with probability, some probability, correct? And you have a concept of crossover and mutation. So I will explain one technique, genetic algorithms, and if you know one technique well, then the other technique you can grab up. So many algorithms are there. You can come to anyone, but again, I'm telling them, don't use them blindly. Okay, then you'll be in trouble. Okay, you can write a lot of papers, but you won't get a good job.
Okay.
So that's important, huh? Because very easy to use them. Huh? So I will slowly, this is the total flowchart, but I will come to the flowchart later. But let us take quickly one example, okay? So this is a simple example, and if you want to do with me, please, those who do not know a genetic algorithm, you can do with me. Very easy problem, you see, what is the problem? Your problem is fx, what is your fx? X into 8 minus x, and there is a range of x. X can vary from 0 to 8. Okay, and you want to find the maxima. So you know, this is a very easy problem, it's continuous, so I will do a derivative, and immediately I will understand, at x equal to what, 4, it will maximize. So why I will use genetic algorithm? No, you should never use genetic algorithm for that, but I'm doing it, why? It's so simple to understand how it works, correct? Then we'll go to the complex problem, maybe from second lecture. The first lecture should be as easy as possible. And we are from computer science, so we understand if you can write a code, you realize, otherwise not. Like, if you are good mathematician, you need to solve more mathematics problem. For computer science also, you'll have to write a code, correct? So I'll go very slowly for this one, because this is a very easy problem, and then I will give clue how we can solve others. So assume, this is your function you want to optimize, correct? And then, as soon as you think that I want to use technique like genetic algorithm, then you need to design, or you need to think about two important issues. So I already told there is a concept of chromosome. Okay? So then, when you think that I want to use this kind of technique, you'll have to tell what is your chromosome. Okay? How it looks like. And what it encodes. So all I need to know that. That is the designer. Designer need to find it. Correct? So for the simplicity, let us assume we will take 8-bit chromosome, you can take any number. You can take 4-bit, you can take, because why I'm talking about bit? Because in the computer, everything should be represented in the array. You can take any real number or anything, no problem. But there's a size, concept of size. You cannot talk about infinity. If you talk about infinite size, then I do not have enough memory. So I need to have a finite number. Okay, so you can take 4-bit, 8-bit, 15-bit, 16-bit, anything. If you increase the number of length of the chromosome, it will take more time to converge. The algorithm will take more time to converge, but your precision will be more. On the other hand, if your size is low, then it might converge quickly, but you may not get the good, best solution. So you need to balance in between, correct? If you are expert, you know how to design it. For the simplicity, right now, assume we are taking 8-bit, it can be anything. And also, for the timing, assume we'll talk about only binary chromosome. Binary means every position can be 1 or 0. But remember, it can be real number, it can be character. If you're solving problem from NLP, you can take character. It can be graph, it can be anything. If you are expert, you can take anything. But until and unless you are expert, you need to talk about simple things. So let us talk about binary 8-bit chromosome. But as soon as I am talking about binary 8-bit chromosome, so what we are telling you? We are telling your minimum is all zero, all position is zero, and that is basically zero. And if your all position is one, what is that? Eight positions I have. 2 to the power 8 minus 1, 255. Correct. And as a designer, let us assume we have the idea that we will encode the parameter X into the chromosome. What we are encoding? Parameter X. Assume this is a function of four variables. So you can encode everything. So maybe first few portion X, Y, Z, everything you can encode. So what you are encoding, that is depending on you, because that is the problem. Correct? How do you define your chromosome? That is most interesting thing. And second thing, so what in this case, what we decided, that we will encode the variable X into the chromosome. Fine? And then you will have to tell whether your chromosome is good or bad. So that means for every chromosome, I will associate some fitness value or objective function, and that objective will tell me whether the chromosome is good or bad. If a chromosome is good, I will have an operation where it will have higher chance of survival. I will show you all these things. Okay. So first things, for this problem, we decided that we will encode parameter X into the chromosome. Correct. And what is your X? X is a variable. Okay. And what is your excess original range? Excess range is zero, between 0 to 8. But as soon as we decided that we will take an 8-bit chromosome, my range become 0 to 255. But my actual range is 0 to 8. So then, if I give you a chromosome, then you will have to first tell me what is the X it carries. For example, this is 100110. So if you convert it into a decimal number, what is this? 0 into 2 to the power 0, 1 into 2 to the power 1, then 0 into 2 to the power 2, and so on. So basically it is 154. You can compute. Correct. We are converting binary to decimal number. It is 154. But actually 154 in which range? 0 to 255. But my actual range is 0 to 8. So I need to map it back to 0 to 8. If I want to do that, I will do. Basically, I need to this range by this range into 154 plus base. Okay. And so basically, 154 in 0 to 255 range is equivalent to 4.831 in this range. Correct? So this is simple mapping. So that means if I give you an 8-bit chromosome, then you will have to tell me what X it is carrying, because it is a single variable function. If there are a number of variables, you can encode X, Y, Z, everything there. Correct? You have a question come out here. Yeah. What? Oh, this is a binary conversion, binary to decimal. Assume I have a number. Let us talk about 4-bit number. What it can be? 0, 0, 0, 0. And we do this one. This 2 into 2 to the power, this is 2 to the power 0, 2 to the power 1, 2 to the power 2, this position, you understand? Correct? If you have a 0, assume I have one bit. So it can be 0 or 1. Fine, either 0 or 1. I have 2-bit, 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0. I can represent 4 state. Physics, if you know quantum or anything. Okay, so this means what? 0, 0 means, so this is my 2 to the power 0 position, this is my 2 to the power 1 position. Correct? So this 2 to the power 0 means 1. So basically it is 0 plus 0. So 0 into 2 to the power 0 plus 0 into 2 to the power 1. So it's 0. Then this is 1 into 2 to the power 0 plus 0 into 2 to the power 1. This is 0 into 2 to the power 0, 1 into 2 to the power 1. And this is 1, this position 1 into 2 to the power 0 and 1 into 2 to the power 1. So this is my what? 0. This is my 1. This is my 2, this is my 3. Fine? So in the same way, if you do it for 8-bit, so 0 into 2 to the power 0, 1 into 2 to the power 1, then 0 into 2 to the power 2, 1 into 2 to the power 3. If you add them, it is basically 154. It's called conversion from binary to decimal. Sorry? This is my LSB, I'm assuming. So least significant bit, 0. Okay, you can do from other side also, depending on your... Anywhere, it's your convention. It's a convention, you can start from right or left. I'm starting from right, you can start from the left. That you need to decide. As an expert, you'll have to tell me. Because I'm a little bit expert, so I'm telling you, let us encode the parameter X. That the designer task. So given a problem, you'll have to tell what your chromosome is. That is designer task, okay? That is the basic issue. And then whether your chromosome is good or bad. Next, this is called objective or fitness. Yes. That I will show you in the next slide. But again, this is designer issue. You won't be able to do it right now, but if you work with genetic algorithm for, or any algorithm for 1 year, you will be able to understand. And you need to know your domain. What domain you are, I mean, like if you are using it for electrical engineering or maybe some physics problem, you'll have to tell because you are domain expert. Okay. Yes, come on. Yeah, basically, actually, I mean, if you go to the function, my actually X is 0 to 8 range. So any X, whatever I'm getting, it should be between 0 to 8. But as soon as I decided my chromosome looks like this, it is basically 0 to 255. So whatever I'm getting between 0 to 255, I need to map it back to 0 to 8. Because actually X is permitted to vary from 0 to 8, not between 0 to 255. That I did it for my convention. I need to map it back. Correct? So this is your, so I understand. As soon as I'm giving you a chromosome, you can find the corresponding X. And as soon as you know the X, what you can do very easy, so you can put the X into here, and whatever FX you will get, that will tell me whether the chromosome is good or bad, what you are expecting. A better value, higher value of X, FX. So basically, assume I have 4 chromosomes. The first one you already seen, another 3. So this is the corresponding X. I convert it, and then I put into the FX function. This is called fitness evaluation, or objective evaluation of the chromosome. I do the fitness evaluation, so I put into the FX, and I get this one, this 4. So these two are your very important designer issue. How I will build my chromosome, and how I will define my objective or fitness. I am telling my objective is FX. You can define in a different way. Right? So you see, you have 4 objective. Now tell me, which is the best chromosome? You are going for maximization. Second is my best. And what is the worst? Third. But if it's the minimization problem, just opposite. So it depends on that. And generally, GA maximizes. So what we do, if you have a minimization problem, you can convert to a maximization by 1 by FX, provided that is not 0. Your denominator is not 0. Or if you think that your denominator can be 0, you can subtract it from a very big number. So 2A, you can convert to a minimization to a maximization. GA generally works with maximization. So if a minimization problem is given, you change your objective to 1 by that, or maybe very big number minus that. When I'm doing 1 by something, I'm assuming denominator cannot be 0. Correct? Fine? You understand, this part is very easy. And I already mentioned there is a concept of population. So generally, GA is called, genetic algorithm is called parallel search. So not only one point at a time you are searching, we are searching a number of points and we are comparing them. Correct? So here basically, every chromosome is your solution. Remember, every chromosome is your solution. So this is called a population. So how many chromosomes I have? 4. So basically I have 4 solutions. It's a parallel search. Not only, there is another technique called simulated annealing. Those who are from statistical mechanics, we also work quite a lot, they know what is simulated annealing. And simulated annealing is a single point search. You have a point, you modify the point. If the next point is better, always accept it. If it is not better, even you can accept it with a probability. Fine, you understand. But GA generally do not work with one point. There's a setup point, and the setup point is called population. So here your population size is 4. It can be anything. It can be anything, and also you can vary your population size, but that is more expertise when you develop. For the time being, assume that my population size is fixed. You can vary it, right? Okay? So, and remember, I mean, like I was talking about simulator annealing, because theoretically simulator annealing is very easy. You have only one operation, mutation. Here you have another operation, crossover. In a simulator annealing, what happened? Assume I have a point, okay, I have a solution, H1, okay, I change it little bit, this is called mutation, I change it little bit, so I got another solution, S1 star. Remember, this is very easy. Simulator annealing is very easy because you have only one operation. Very quickly you understand. So then I will see if S1 star is better than S1, then what I will do? Accept S1 start. That means my earlier position was in S1, I will jump to S1 start because that is better. Fine. If, on the other hand, S1 is better than S1 star, that means what? You are going to a bad position. Your previous position was better. Even then I will accept. So that is the trick. If you only go by this is called greedy method. So this is called greedy. I'm getting better, always I will accept that. In computer science or mathematically also you can show, it's called greedy method. And if you do greedy method, then there is a high chance that you will be trapped to local optimum. Again, that thing is coming. So that means sometimes you will have to accept even poor solution also. If it is a good solution, generally you accept. No, fine. But even if sometimes we need to take a poor solution also, only then you can guarantee that I will go towards global. Otherwise, greedy. In computer science, it's very famous. Greedy algorithm won't give you optimal. It may not. It can give you, but it may not guarantee you that you will get the optimal. So even then, better than N1, even then accept, depending on the, there's a called energy function. So if you see S1 and S1 star, I'm not writing the algorithm, it's energy difference, and also there is a temperature schedule. Accept with this energy, and there's a temperature schedule. It should be a function of both. Okay, so that means I can accept a poor solution depending on many things. How if it is very poor, don't accept it. It's a little bit of poor, your acceptance chance will be high. And there is a temperature scheduling also. And why it is coming from statistical mechanics? Because in the statistical mechanics, assume there is a hot body, you want to cool it. The idea is if you always cool it, you won't be able to get to the minimum position, minimum energy. Rather, what you do, cool it for some time, then again hot it little bit, again cool it. So this is called very interesting thing. Then you will go to more minima. If you always cool it, you cannot reach that state. So that is very coming directly from statistical mechanics. But simulator annealing is easy because always you are searching with one point. You are updating the point and either you are taking a move or not move. Okay, we did a lot of work with simulator annealing. But let us talk about GA. But GA is basically not one, it's a multiple. You are not searching one point. You are searching n number of points. Here n equal to 4. Your population size is 4. So now I already mentioned an operation in GA. First operation is called selection. Then crossover, then mutation. What is selection? So assume that I have 4 such chromosomes. You already understand. I have 4 such chromosomes. I know the parameter x, so I know fx. I know their objective. Correct? This is my objective. Okay? Then there's a concept of mating pool. That means from your 4 population size, you are creating one mating pool. So in the mating pool, you will pick up one after another chromosome. Generally, population size and mating pool size are same. It can vary also, if you are expert. So if I have population size 4, in the mating pool, I will pick up 4 chromosomes. Now, what 4 chromosome I will be picking up? That is important. So we'll pick up it according to the it fitness. So basically, we are following Darwinian principle of survival of the fittest. That means a chromosome whose fitness is high or objective is high, it will get more chance to come into the mating pool. Fine. So what I have four such chromosomes. So basically, this is a roulette wheel. Famous gremlin thing you already know. How do you play? So you will rotate it, and when it will stop, the marker will point to some position and you pick up that one. So that's the roulette wheel strategy. So in the selection, there could be a lot of strategies. One of them is called roulette wheel or proportional selection. What is proportional? First, there are the whole roulette, 360 degree, or whole area, I will divide it into number of areas. How many chromosomes you have? Four. So I will divide it into four areas, and I will allocate some area according to its fitness. So from that, what we can conclude? Two will get more area, most area. More area will get by two, and three will get less area. Fine? So you see, according to fitness, we will allocate some areas. But if you want to write a computer program, what you'll do? Very easy. You take a cumulative sum. Okay, so let us forget about the last two digits. So after this one, my cumulative sum is 15.30. Fine? Then the second one, you have 30.70, then 30.70, then 35 point something, then 47 point something. So now you generate a random number between 0 to 40 maximum. So if it is less than 15.30, that means you are picking up the first chromosome. If it is between 15.30 to 30.70, you are basically picking up the second one. So basically, very easy. So if you implement such a function, that means you are implementing this proportional roulette wheel selection. Okay? So basically, those are from computer science, you know, you can have a S-rand, C-rand function. Assume it's a very good random number. If it is not, takes help from the mathematics people. If you have a good random number generating function, which is difficult, so you can generate a random number and then pick up the corresponding chromosome. And it may happen, so how many times you'll do that? So because you have four chromosomes in the population and you want to create a mating pool of size four. So four times you need to call the function or rotate the wheel. Correct? So basically it may happen that some chromosome may selected twice, some chromosome may vanished. But be remember, even the poorest has also some chance. If somebody is very poor, even that also has some chance. So this is basically you are following natural genetic system. These things happen in the nature. If some chromosome is good, they have a high chance. Even if some chromosome is not good, even that also have some chance. That's the reason it works. Okay? So this is called selection. Then you have two more operations, so this is fine. First one is called crossover. There are a number of crossover operations. One of them is called single point crossover. What is crossover? So you understand, after selection, so I have a population of size 4. So this is my population of size 4. For every chromosome, I find it objective or fitness. And then I create a mating pool of size 4. So from the mating pool, what I will do? I will first pick up, so let us assume in the mating pool also I have 4 chromosomes. So I will pick up the first two, I will do a crossover, and then I will put into the next places. Okay? And then again I will pick up the next two, I will crossover, and I will generate another two offspring or child. So this is called single point crossover, very easy. So basically this is my first chromosome, that one. So size is 8, so you generate a random number between 1 to 7, okay, assume it is that. So if you have a like single point like that, you take the left-hand side of the first and right-hand side of the second, that is your first child or first offspring. Similarly, for the second, you do the same thing, this part and this part, the second chromosome, fine, or offspring. So basically you picked up two parents, generate two offspring. And this is called crossover. What? Why crossover? I am exchanging some information. And natural genetic system also same thing happened. After mating, basically they exchange some information. And you are expecting with that information, things will be much better. So this is crossover. Okay, single, it can be multi-point crossover also. Sorry? Huh? Three from the middle. You can do everything. So whatever I am telling is basic operation. You can do everything. You can play. But as soon as you expert, you will understand which playing will give you good result. So that is the expertise. You can do everything. So So these are all, I mean, whatever people did, you can always extend. We did a lot of work, okay? But then if there is some mathematician, they will ask you, show that if you do that, you will get a better one. So then you will have to do Markov chain analysis. So randomly if you do, maybe you will be getting good result, but mathematicians won't be happy. So you'll have to show them that your method is. Then I won't discuss Markov chain analysis, but you can always. It's not easy because you have two operations. One is called mutation, another is crossover. But if you do simulated annealing, only one operation, it's easy. So finding the probability and then continuing is easy. So this is crossover, very simple. And then you have another operation, it's called mutation. Why we do mutation? To put some diversity. And what is mutation? Abrupt change, correct? So basically, assume you have a chromosome like that, okay? So every position you go, you decide what you want to do a mutation or not. And it's the easy, it's a binary. So what is a mutation? In a binary position, just flipping the bit. If there's a zero, change it to one and vice versa. So you change it, correct? So this is your mutation. So this position I want to mute, I change it from 0 to 1, similarly 1 to 0, other position simply I will copy it. But remember, in the nature, what happened? Nature, we already know that crossover happened more, mutation happened less. So in the program also, when we'll do it, we'll keep our crossover probability high. So there is concept of probability that always we won't do crossover. Maybe if your crossover point is probability is 0.8 or 0.9, that means out of 100 times, 90% times you'll do the crossover, 80% time you'll cross the crossover. And generally mutation probability is very low, 0.1 or maybe 0.1 or 0.01. That means out of 100, one time you'll do mutation. Okay. So generally mutation probability is low. So this is looks like, okay. So let me go back the flowchart quickly, you will understand now, the whole GA process, how it works. So this is my flowchart. So basically what will happen, assume there is a problem. So you'll have to design the chromosome first. For fx equal to x into 8 minus x, we decided that we'll take x, the parameter, and we'll encode into the chromosome. That you need to decide as a designer. We'll take some more example and you will find it. Okay, then for every chromosome, you'll have to find it, evaluate its fitness or goodness. And that will tell whether your chromosome is good or bad. Then, do you want to terminate? So how to terminate? Maybe if the problem is simple, because GA goes into the loop. So one by one iteration, okay? So if your problem is simple, maybe you can go for 20 iteration or 30 iteration. This is one way. A better way, you understand, because what I'm doing, every chromosome is my solution. At the end of the day, the best chromosome is my solution. Whatever is the best, because I'm talking about single objective. And single objective, assume, again, you are talking about the TSP. Assume there are 20 city. So one of your friend is giving me a solution, maybe 78,000 rupees. And another friend is giving 75,000 rupees. For me, which is better? 75,000. So for single objective, it is very easy to understand which one is better than the other. So finally, whichever is the best, I will accept that, my solution, as a solution. Okay? And that's the reason there is a concept of elitism. I will come to that. So you need to incorporate elitism. Without elitism, GA won't work. Okay? But let us go to the flowchart. So one termination criteria, you go for the 20 iteration, or 30 iteration, 40 iteration. The next one, I will always keep track of my best chromosome. If I find, maybe at 72 iteration, the best chromosome, 73, 4, 5, 6, it is not improving. That means even if you continue, nothing will happen. Maybe you can stop. So you can look towards your best chromosome. Even better, I don't want to look toward the best, but I want to take the average. And theoretically, you can always show that if the process is not saturated, your average fitness will start it increasing. Average means I have n chromosomes, I will take everybody's fitness, I will average, do the average. And from iteration to iteration, if your average is not improving for maybe 5 iteration, you can stop. So that is the best. So I'm not taking any decision like 5 iteration or 10 iteration. I'm looking towards the chromosome. If they are not matured enough, I will continue. If they are matured, I will stop the process. Okay. And then if you terminate that your final result is, you know, your best chromosome is your final solution. That is your output. If not, then you have 3 operations every time. You are doing fast selection. We discuss one roulette wheel, proportional selection. You can do anything. There are so many selection criteria. Okay, tournament selection. You take two chromosomes and then you do it something. So many are there in the literature. This is the easiest. Okay, and then you have crossover. In the crossover also, you can have so many operations. We just discussed simple single prime crossover. You can have multiple and anything. And also mutation. And after selection, crossover, mutation, your chromosome set will change. Correct? Because the same population has changed to a new population. So again, you'll have to find the fitness of all chromosomes. And then you'll have to go to this loop. Not here. Because initialized population, I will do only once. And then every time I have a new set of chromosome with new fitness, I will continue. And after some time, I will stop. Okay? So this is the whole process. Now, what is elitism? That is very interesting. Elitism is masked. Let me talk about elitism, and then I will maybe go back to that. Termination criteria, I already discussed. This is elitism. What is elitism? Assume that I'm starting the process, iteration zero. So I have a set of chromosomes. Let me finish elitism, then I can go back. Because elitism is very important. Without elitism, you won't get any result. Okay, because you already understand, G is a kind of random process. Because you have a probability, concept of probability, selection, you have a concept of probability. So it's a probabilistic. We called it guided probability, not random probability. You are guided by the fitness. Okay, objective function is guiding you. So why elitism is masked? Because it may happen that maybe somewhere in your, when you are going through the iteration, so basically GA iterate one, then next, so on. So maybe I-8 you have a very good solution. You may lose it in I+2 or I+3. So what people suggest, you always try to keep track of your best chromosome you have seen so far. So what I will do, I am in the first iteration. So whatever is the best, maybe I can keep a copy outside. Okay, so then in the next iteration, if I find something even better than this one, I'll copy this into that. That means always I will keep track of my best. And if I can keep track of my best thing, that is called elitism. And if you ensure elitism, always will be able to generate result. Maybe you can come with your... Tell me. Sorry? No, again, I'm telling you that even mathematically, I can show you that I will be able to maximize or optimization. I mean, maximization and minimization. I can tell you there are a lot of theories. If you apply GA, always you will get good result if you can design well. Okay. Mathematically, it is possible to show you that you will get your best result, but for that, you need to run it for a long time. But good thing is that we can always show you some result that your average population, I mean that average fitness is increasing. There's a Markov model you can do the solution. There's a schema theorem, I'll talk to that. Maybe I won't do the detailing, but the schema theorem I will do. I will show you. That depends. I mean generally, if you are very intelligent, you can do a very, very good crossover with the idea. There is a concept of building block. What I will come to that basically. The building block concept, and you talked about random, correct? But if you have domain knowledge, although this problem we started from a random, if you have very good domain knowledge, from that domain knowledge itself, you can design one heuristic. And it is important if you have very good result, because generally GA is used for very complicated problem. But from the domain knowledge, if you can generate some good solution, put it into the initial solution of the GA. That is another thing. And the crossover, you are right, that the idea is that, assume I have a chromosome. So what people expect, some part of the chromosome is good. That is called building block. And can you keep your building block intact? So that is very important. So that means I have a very good building block in one chromosome and very good in another. If that two things can come, maybe my whole chromosome will be better. So that is very, very interesting thing. So that people did a lot of work, but nowadays multi-objective, everything is going to multi-objective. And there are a lot of mathematics also. It's not an easy process, but generally, I mean, if you are more expert, then you can design your crossover in a better way. But those who are not good in mathematics or they don't do all this analysis, they can be happy with At least you will get some result, okay. But one more thing, I will come to the building block part because that is more mathematics. Another thing, this is, I already explained, that population size is usually fixed, you can vary. Your population size may not be fixed. Similarly, string length usually fixed, I will show you an example where you need variable length. Here what we assume, all the chromosomes have length 8. But it may happen in the same population, some chromosome length is 4, some is 8, some is 14, it may happen. And then you need to redefine your crossover. Okay, we'll show it. Then mu c is kept high, mu m is already mentioned, low. Termination criteria, again things. Another thing is that you may also do it adaptive. Adaptive means maybe it is expected, like you understand, what is mutation? Mutation means random jump. So initially, when you are starting the process, a random jump might be better, correct? As soon as you are like very close to your actual solution, it is not good to have a random jump. So what you can do, initially your mutation may be high, and then slowly, slowly you can bring it down. Okay, that's called adaptive. Similarly, crossover also you can change with the time. Generally, people keep it fixed, but you can do it adaptive also. But remember one thing, although we are talking so much, you will immediately understand that crossover is not must, but mutation is a must. Why? Assume I have a population. If I write this side, you can see, correct? I have a population like this one. Let us talk about 4. Fine? Assume this is my population, anytime, ith. Iteration, maybe 38 iteration. I got these 4 chromosomes. And by chance, assume my final solution, the best chromosome, there is an one in the right-hand side. Correct? One in the right-hand side. So you do as many crossover as you like, you cannot bring a one into the right. Can you do? You understand? Assume my final solution looks like 1001. This is my best solution. Okay? So somehow at ith iteration, maybe 30 or 29th, I am here. So now you can do as many crossover as possible. You will be never able to go to that one. What that means? That means mutation is a must. Crossover is not must. So if you are very intelligent, you can remove the crossover operator. But you cannot remove mutation operator. But mutation should be rare. Mutation means random jump. Okay? And yeah, long. Generally, it depends. But again, I told it's very difficult process. That's the reason how do you define your mutation. That is important. But remember, if I have a large population size, for individual cases, my mutation is low. But if I'm taking n is very large, then high chance on the right-hand side I have a mutation. So overall probability increases. Okay, everywhere you have a low, low, low. But one position, N is high, number of chromosomes. Okay. So that's the reason the mathematics is not very easy. Okay. So what time generally you stop? Maybe I do not know. Termination criteria. Then theories of GA. This is the analytic part of GA. This is called schema theorem. Okay. So I will just talk about the schema theorem and then I will stop this portion because then you need to do HMM analysis and all these things become more complex. What is a schema? Now that is important. The schema is a template that may match several chromosomes. For an 8-bit chromosome, so a schema, this one means, if I put 10, so basically it's 8-bit, correct? So if I put some 10, some position, that means I can match with that chromosome where that places there is a 10. If I put a star, it can be anything. So you understand, if I write this one, so basically let us talk about four chromosome of 4 length. So this, if this is my schema, then this schema matches with what? Definitely it matches with, if I put 0 here, 1, 0, 0, it matches because this two position matches. This also matches with 0, 1, 0, then 1, then 0, not 0, 1, 0, You put a zero there, one, and then one, one, zero, one. So basically these four, if you tell this is my schema, 4-bit, so basically these four chromosome matches with that one. So this is called schema. You understand? Fine? So star means it can be anything, one or zero. So schema is very interesting if you do the mathematical solution. And yeah, you'll have to, you can mathematically say that, but these two positions should be 1-0 always. If I tell, no, if these two positions, any positions, you, in the schema, some positions are defined. Like if out of 8, no positions is defined, it matches with every 255. Because with 8 positions, how many binary chromosomes I can generate? 255. If my all position is star, basically all chromosomes matches with the schema. But as soon as I define one, that means what? It cannot match with 255, you are counting down. So similarly, if you define some position, your number of matches will come down. Okay? And now, as soon as you have a kind of schema, now the length of the schema is different between your last and first definite position. So it is last defined position minus first defined position. One. So assume I have a schema like this one. Not this. I have a schema like this one. Then what it is? Two. It's called length of the schema. Okay? Fine. And you have order of the schema, number of defined position. How many positions defined? Two. If three positions defined, three. So on. Okay. Average fitness of the schema. Average fitness of schema means, so average fitness of the, all the chromosomes with which this schema matches. Understand? Let us go to the other one, previous one. So this is my 1-0 star. So this schema matches with 4. So average fitness of this schema means what? I will take all these chromosomes' fitness and then I will do the average. This is called average fitness of all the chroma. Now, if you know this is called schema theorem. I don't want to go into the detail, it is there. So this you can understand. Okay. So this is the schema, the first one. Matches string is this one. Okay, only 1-0. These two position is fine. Okay, this is the length, sometimes order and so on. But what is the schema theorem? That is very important. So I will go to the... So this is all about schema. You can read by yourself, not very complicated. The complicated thing starts with the mathematical part. So the schema theorem, this is interesting. This is telling the schema with, schema you understand, with above average fitness are sampled, generated after generation by an increasing number of chromosomes. This is the theory. That means mathematically you can always show that short schema with above average fitness, schema with above average fitness will increase from generation to generation. That means what you can expect, your average fitness is improving. Correct. So this you can prove. Mathematically this is very useful because from that at least you can argue that my average fitness of the schema will increase. Okay? And there is also concept of building block. Somebody was telling some part of the chromosome might be good, some part maybe not so good. So you can, if you are good, you can play with that. So maybe your concept is how to bring this part with the other part. Okay. So you can do a lot of hidden markup things. This shows that above average schema will receive an exponentially increased number of instant in subsequent generation. It started increasing. Okay. So that gives you a good idea that GA will work. Okay. So otherwise it's so random, people are very unhappy. Theoretically it works, so basically you can do some hidden analysis, but I'm not doing that, so I'm excluding, but I'm going to a very quickly example of, so basically you need to do Markov analysis. So it's another need, but you can, if you are interested, you can read. I will give the slides with you. Give the slides. But this is the current trend. Current trend means also 10 years back, but current trend will go. So basically we are talking about binary. Encoding can be integer, it can be real number, it can be graph, anything. Operations. Any operation you can do. We simply define three operations: selection, crossover, mutation. You can do anything. And also sometimes it's recommended do a local search. I'll show you. So every time, after every iteration, if you can do a local search, I mean, whatever domain knowledge you have, help the GA, because it's sometimes the problems are so complicated. If you help the GA process, it will converge quickly. Okay. So incorporate local search. Handling, constraint handling. You can do a lot of constraint handling. For TSP, one of the constraints could be, I can't pay more than 1 lakh rupees. That means, please don't mean give any solution which is more than 1 lakh. Correct? You TSP one. So I'm talking about total cost. So at the beginning of the problem, you may have some constraint. The constraint can be soft and hard. And in the problem itself, you can introduce the constraint. Yeah, that means it won't generate any solution where the total cost is more than 1 lakh. Similarly, you may have time constraint if you are multi-objective. So you tell, I cannot spend more than 28 days. Soft means I can spend between 28 to 30 days. Not more than 30 days, but I will be happy if it is less than 28 days. Similarly, money, I cannot spend more than 1 lakh, but I will be happy if you can give me a solution within 80,000. 80,000 is my first choice, but my maximum hard limit is 1 lakh rupees. So all these constraints you can incorporate in the problem. And then you have to design your own operator in such a way that you won't generate any solution or a chromosome which violate that principle. Right? So that you can do. Every chromosome is your solution, so you don't generate any solutions which violate your constraint, at least hard constraint. So this you can do. This is called constraint handling. Okay? And it's called multi-objective. Nowadays, people talk about multi-objective, multi-constraint. You have so many constraints. So all these constraints you can put in the problem. Okay, accordingly you can design it. That is possible. Easy. And nowadays, these are the common scenario. So current trend. So these are multi-objective optimization. You talk about not simple GA. It's called NSGA2. Alan Mohadev developed this. Anirban and I worked quite a lot with that. So Anirban will explain. And then this is from Eric Jittler group, ETH Zurich, another. So it's Pareto-based. And this is from our group. It is based on simulated annealing. So this is called, when as soon as you have, I will just maybe 2 minutes, I will introduce what is multi-objective. And maybe after that one, I will again go back to the single objective. I will take another example from data science. Okay. So what is multi-objective? This is from our group, based on AMOSA. And actually what happened, like we are talking about genetic algorithms. So if you are very good, you can incorporate any different things from the soft computing domain. Like we did a lot of work where we used fuzzy theory with genetic algorithms. You can use neural network with, like many times designing the architecture of deep neural network or neural network is difficult. So you can use GA for that. Okay, so if you are good, like fuzzy washing machine, you already there? And neurofuzzy is very, very established subject. Okay. One of my students is doing work where we are using fuzzy theory with deep neural network. Okay. So basically, if you can intelligently combine more than one component from the soft computing techniques, you can even do better. Correct. So be sure that you can have the expertise to, use more than one techniques. NLP also, like your fuzzy, has a lot of issues. So this is multi-objective. I think Anirban will explain more. The idea is that, assume so far we are talking about only cost. But now let us talk about cost and time. Okay, we want to do minimization, but for the example, assume this is one by cost and one by time. Fine? So now I have two objectives. Okay, so this is called multi-objective. And if the objective is more than three or four, it is called many objective. Problem will be more difficult. And in the aeronautic design, there are a lot of problems where you have number of objective more than four. Then it's another level of research. We can discuss, but maybe tomorrow at the end I will discuss, not now. Okay, in case of two objectives, see what the problem is. So what you are looking for, you have two solutions, F1 and F2. Okay, so you two objectives. So assume first solution is one. You got a solution one. Fine. Okay, this is the only solution, you accept it. Then after some time, assume you got another solution 5. Now you look towards 1 and 5. What will happen? 1 is better than 5 in F2. And 5 is better than 1 is F1. So you cannot tell 1 is better than 5 or the vice versa. Both of them are good. So they are called non-dominating. So single objective, we have a concept of this is better than that, that is better than that. Multi-objective is very difficult sometimes. So basically, multi-objective, we are not looking for one solution. We are looking for a set of solutions. And we are looking for set of non-dominating solution. That is very interesting. And the concept was coming from this is called Pareto optimality. Okay, and Pareto was a Nobel laureate. And it is a huge important in economics. What is the concept? Concept is that if you have 1 and 5, you keep both of them with you. But as soon as you get 2, you see 2 is better than 5 in both the objective. So you can discard 5. Let us quickly take an example, otherwise you'll be lost. Maybe assume again you, very interesting it is. Let us talk about TSP, traveling salesman problem. I have time and I have money, correct, cost. Time maybe in days and cost is maybe rupees, let us talk. So let us assume I have first solution, solution 1. Time is 28 days, cost maybe 78,000. Okay, then maybe S2 is, or maybe put one more, some more, because 28 days you cannot do. So S2 is more time, but less money. And then you have another solution, S3, maybe 31 days, but 180. Now, if you look towards these solutions, you all immediately understand this is not useful. So this is called dominated. Maybe Anirban will mathematically tell you how do you define it. But very easy it is. You see, this one is more in time and cost. So you can simply drop that. But in between two, you cannot, very difficult for you to tell. So maybe the idea is that if you can show it to the end user, maybe he will tell, okay, fine, I can give my maybe 28,000 more. This money I can spend, no problem, but I want my representative to come back. 2 days is more important. So if you give them the end result, sometime the user very easily can tell you, I want this solution. Some cases it is difficult, some cases it is easy. Okay, so this is called the concept of domination and non-domination. So 5 is dominated by 1, 2, 3, 4. But you see 1, 2, 3, 4, they are non-dominating with each other. So multi-objective, you have a concept of domination and non-domination. And basically we try to find the non-dominating solution. And in single objective, what you do, you try to push your good solution. Good, better, best, correct. You're pushing. But here we don't push the good solution, we push the surface. We try to push the surface. This is called Pareto optimal surface, correct. 1, 2, 3, 4, and you push it. And I'm trying to figure out the best surface. And all the solution in the best surface is my solution. Okay, that is a set of solution, not one solution. And then I will give it to the end user, and then end user is happy, he can pick up one. So how to pick a one? It's again interesting. If I give you n solutions, which one you will take? So a lot of issues are there, correct? Okay, fine. So this is our paper. Yeah. Sorry? How to understand which is dominating and non-dominating? Or? Non-dominating. You see? So, now it dominates 5. What do you mean? So non-dominating solution means, you see, 1 and 2, if you compare between 1 and 2, 2 is better than 1 in F1, and 1 is better than 2 in F2. Similarly, if you compare 3 with 2 or 1, 1 is better in one objective, another is better in another objective. So they are non-dominating. If you have two solutions where the one solution beat the other solution in every objective, then you call this dominate that. Right? No. 5, 5. Dominated solution. 2, 3, 4. Now actually what happened? 2, 3, 4 and 1. I forget to write 1. They dominate 5. Five. Five is dominated by, not by one, five is dominated by 2, 3, 4. Yeah. But if you only consider 1 and 5, they're non-dominating. So in the computer that happens. Initially I start with one solution, then as soon as I will get 5, I cannot throw 5, because 1 and 5 both are non-dominating. But as soon as you get 1 up, 2, 3, 4, you can discard 5. Because 5 is no more required. Fine, but if I have only 1 and 5, I cannot discard anything, because 1 and 5 are non-dominating with each other. But as soon as I have 2, 3, 4, one of them, I can discard 5. This is very easy, but even you have one more constraint, you have a memory, because if your objective started increasing, 2 is fine, 3 is okay. But if your objective started increasing, then what will happen? You will generate huge number of non-dominating solutions. And in the computer, you have a memory restriction. So you cannot keep every one of them. Fine? So you need to have a trick how to do. It's called, Anirban will explain. Another interesting thing, I mean, is there anything? 1, 2, 3, 4, but dominating, non-dominating, you can discuss tomorrow, maybe sometimes, or maybe today evening. Huh? Some example, and then you will understand more. How do you define dominating and non-dominating? Correct. So these are very interesting, because after 3, 4 problems becoming more important, more difficult. It's called many objective optimization. So maybe quickly, some references. This is from clustering, and this one. This is from computational biology, but GA, you can read it from Goldberg. Goldberg was one of the first. I will give you some, maybe you have in your slide, maybe Goldberg's book and anything. Okay, so, but I mean, don't read any book, just download some tutorial. And if you understand GA, you can quickly go to other one. Okay, so maybe another, what time is your break? 11. So these are a perfect time for stop. So if you have any question, you can ask. These are our works, or this is the second book is by Goldberg. So he was a civil engineer. So, and this third book is also good, Mikhailovsky. But don't go to any book, because nowadays things have like, go to multi-objective. So you read more multi-objective. Lot of tutorials are there, okay. And David Fogel is again another interesting. Kalan Devs, huh? Yeah, this is another. This is for multi-objective. But he was very close friend to us, but moved to USA now. Okay. Carlos is our good friend. We have joint project, and we published, Anirban also published with. And in my paper, you find that Kallandev is also there. Okay, so we wrote a lot of paper together, and good friend, but Carlos is in Mexico. Kallandev was in IIT Kanpur, moved to USA now. But these are useful. I mean, multi-objective is more useful. Okay. So more references, our paper, and we have first book from Spinger on multi-objective clustering, maybe. Anirban will explain, or I will explain. Let me stop. If you have any question, you ask me, or during the lunch, or dinner, or breakfast. 2 days I will be here. And any time you want to send me a mail, please drop a mail. Maybe how much time you have for the coffee break? 10, 15 minutes? Half an hour. Then we'll start again a little bit of data science and machine learning. Then I will show how to apply this kind of tools. Okay. Fine. Thank you very much for your patience.